morning. Myself is Santosh Bharti. Now, last lecture I have discussed about the ray theory model for optical fiber communication and how many rays are traveled inside the fiber. So there are, last lecture I told, there are three types of ray are traveling inside the core of the optical fiber. One is the axial rays. Axial rays, which are basically passing through the axis of the fiber, are passing through the center of the fiber. And other is the meridional ray. Meridional ray means ray who intercept the axis of the fiber or who intercept the center of the fiber. Basically, ray travel by the total internal reflection. So that ray is known as the meridional ray. And other ray are the skew rays. Skew ray means the ray passing in the core region by making the helical path inside the, by touching the diameter, internal diameter of the core of the optical fiber. So there are three different types of rays propagating inside the fiber. So then types of fiber, there are two types of fiber. One is the step index fiber. Why it is called step index fiber? Because the refractive index of the core and the refractive index of the cladding, so there is the step change or abrupt change between the refractive index of the core to the refractive index of the cladding. So that's why it is called the step index fiber. And other is the graded index fiber. Graded index fiber means there is a gradual change of the refractive index from core to fiber. That's why it is called graded index fiber, right? So they have some fundamental parameters related to the step index fiber and the graded index fiber. Now you can see by this formula. First, the numerical aperture. Numerical aperture is equals to under root n1 square minus n2 square, where n1 is the refractive index of the core and n2 is the refractive index of the cladding. And this is also equals to sine theta a. Theta is the acceptance angle. What is acceptance angle? Because the angle by which the incident rays are accepted by the optical fiber. Beyond this angle, now incident ray, incident light do not accept by the fiber. It is rejected by the fiber. So this angle is basically known as acceptance angle. Other parameter is the, now you can also define the numerical aperture with the relative refractive index different. That is n1 under root 2 delta. Delta is the relative refractive index difference. This is equal to under root n1 square minus n2 square upon 2n1 square. Or if the difference between refractive index of core and cladding is very very small, now we can assume this value is n1 minus n2 upon n1. So this is the numerical aperture. Other parameter is the acceptance angle. Acceptance angle is basically, this is equal to sine inverse numerical aperture. And third parameter is the solid acceptance angle. Basically this is om equals to pi na square. Pi na square or pi n1 square minus n2 square. So these are the parameters related to the step index fiber. Some other parameters, that is the how to define the refractive index of index step index fiber. So refractive index of step index fiber n1, when r is less than, radial distance is less than radius of the fiber, means this is the core region, and n2, refractive index of the cladding region. Propagation constant. Propagation constant is defined by the 2 pi n1 by lambda cos theta. Cos theta, theta is the acceptance angle. And normalized propagation constant, this is beta upon beta naught. This is also known as effective refractive index. So effective refractive index square upon n1 square upon n1 minus n2 square. And beta naught is the propagation constant for the free space, 2 pi by lambda. So these are the parameters which I already discussed in the classroom. So these parameters related to the step index fiber, and similarly some other parameters also related to the gradient index fiber. Gradient index fiber, basically, so this is the index profile of the gradient index fiber. Now you can see, this is the N2, refractive index of the cladding region, and this is the N1. N1 is a function of radial distance at the center. At the center, basically the refractive index is N1, and at this point, this is less than R1, this point less than R1. So basically, this the refractive index is the function of radial distance R, nR. Clear? So there is a gradual change between the refractive index of core to the refractive index of the cladding. So this gradual changing of the refractive index profile because of this, now it is called as the gradient index fiber, right? So there are again certain parameter related to the numerical aperture. Again, basically the refractive index is a function of radial distance. Then numerical aperture also is a function of refractive index. So this is equal to n r 1 n 2 square, where n r is n 1 under root 1 minus 2 delta r by a power alpha, where alpha is the profile parameter. So optimum value of alpha is again 2. Again 2 means at this value of profile parameter, now dispersion is very very small, dispersion is very very minimum. We have to be assumed that the profile parameter is 2. Then again, by using the same relationship, you can also calculate the acceptance angle, solid acceptance angle, propagation constant, normalized propagation constant, and mods of the fiber. So these all parameters related to the step index fiber and the graded index fiber. Now in next slide, now you can see the other parameters. In other parameters means, you can see here, in step index fiber, in core region only refractive index defined by N1, cladding by N2, but here not. In core region, N1 multiplied by under root 1 minus 2 delta R by A upon alpha. A is the radius of the core, R is the radial distance, alpha is the profile parameter, and delta is the relative refractive index difference. Clear? And basically N1 under root 1 minus 2 delta. This delta is very very minimum. So this value is approximately same as the N2. So this is the refractive index for the cladding. Clear? Propagation constant, again the function of radial distance. Normalized propagation constant. Now this value, V number 2 pi A by lambda, and the numerical aperture, the function of the radial distance. So these are the parameters corresponding to the gradient index fiber. So from this diagram, you can see the transmission characteristics of the step index fiber and the gradient index fiber. So you can see, basically, this is the optical fiber. This is the core region and these are the cladding region. This is the optical sources. These optical sources may be the LED kind, may be the laser kind. Either it is LED or laser. This is the optical sources. Now you can see here, light emitting from the optical sources. This is the incident ray from the optical sources. This is the axial ray. Why it is axial ray? Because it is passing through the axis of the fiber, or it is passing through the center of the fiber. This ray is traveling inside the core region by total internal reflection. By total internal reflection means this ray is known as the meridional ray. Again, incidence angle is different, means the ray trajectory is different in the step index fiber. And this is the input pulses you have to apply at the optical sources, and at the output of the fiber you will find the amplitude is reduces and the width are increases, but energy or power remain constant. So here this is the delta tau. So delta tau of this input pulses is much much smaller than the delta tau of the output pulses. Basically the dispersion occurs in the multimode gradient index fiber. So this is the related to the step index fiber. Now you can see the rate trajectory of the gradient index fiber. So this is the gradient index fiber. optical source, I mean LED or laser diode, light emitting from the source, axial rays through the gradient index fiber. Now you can see there is a gradual change. Now you can see here, this is the at the center refractive index is the very high, and when you move away from the center, now refractive index are decreases. Refractive index are decreases means concentration is decreases. Concentration decreases means speed of light is increases. So you can see here at this point the speed is low. When you move from center to radial core cladding boundary, concentration is reduces, means speed is increases, means it slowly then high speed, then slowly 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 high speed, slowly slowly high speed, clear? But here you can say now this ray is reaching there, this reaching there, this reaching there. So there is the now delta t. There is a time difference of the reaching individual ray at the destination point. This is the group delay. Because of this group delay, now the dispersion is occurs. But in the gradient index fiber, all ray reaching at the destination point at the same time. So the delta t in ideal situation, delta t is negligible. No group delay exists, but in practical situation, the group delay is very very minimum. Now you can see from this figure, so dispersion in gradient fiber is very very minimum. Now you can see all ray traveling at the same time at the destination point. So delta t is very very small. That's why the dispersion is also very very small in gradient index fiber. Clear? So these again the transmission characteristics related to the dispersion of the stiff index fiber and the gradient index fiber. Now come to the limitations of the ray model. When we analyze optical communication ray trajectory through the stiff index fiber or through the gradient index fiber, now we can find the dispersion or exist. The magnitude of dispersion in stiff index fiber is greater than the magnitude of the dispersion in the gradient index fiber. So there are certain limits of the ray model. So first, the ray model gives an impression that during total internal reflection, the energy is confined to the core only. The ray model states that the total energy is confined in core region by the total internal reflection. Means there is no any energy is moving in the cladding region. Clear? But it is not so. In reality, the practical, the optical energy spreads cladding also. Clear? So this will explain by the wave model. And second limitation, the ray model does not speak of the discrete field patterns propagation inside the fiber. Means it doesn't tell which type of fields are propagating inside the fiber. Electromagnetic field are propagating inside the fiber, or longitudinal fields are propagating inside the fiber, or longitudinal fields are which modes of field are traveling inside the fiber. So this cannot be described by the ray model. And last limitations of the ray model breaks down if the size of the core, radius of the fiber is approximately same as the operating wavelength. Now the breaks the decision of the optical fiber. It doesn't give the accurate value of the optical fiber. So the ray model breaks down when the core size becomes comparable to the wavelength of the light. The ray model therefore is not quite justified for the single mode fiber. So these limitations can be overcome by the wave model. Now I am going to discuss about the wave model. Yeah? So by ray model we can only calculate the numerical aperture of the fibers, acceptance angle of the fiber, solid acceptance angle, propagation constant, but it doesn't tell us about which type of the fields are propagating inside the fiber. By total internal reflection, how much magnitude of energy is also propagating in the core region, also propagating in the cladding region. What magnitude of energy is propagating through the center of the fiber or axis of the fiber. Now I am going to discuss about the wave theory model. Before starting the wave theory model, I'd like to know about the what is the wave front. Wave front is always perpendicular to the wave propagation, direction of the wave propagation. So we have here two medium. One is the spherical mediums, another is the plane wave. Spherical wave and plane wave. You can see, so these are the direction of the wave propagation, direction of the ray propagation. And these lines, vertical lines, show the wave front. Wave front corresponding to plane wave. You can see here, this wave front is always perpendicular to the direction of wave propagation. In similar way, in spherical wave, the wave front is also perpendicular. Now you can see this is the direction of wave propagation. This is, and this is the wave front corresponding to the direction of wave propagation. So these are the wave front. Wave front is very helpful for propagating the signal inside the fiber or inside the medium, inside the any medium. And it is true, wave front is always perpendicular to the direction of wave propagation. Clear? Then come to the by total internal reflection, how wave fronts are generated inside the core region, inside the optical fiber. So this structure is the optical fiber cable, and this is the core region, this is the cladding region, and here we apply the optical sources which emit the light. This is the, we assume that the this incident light and by total internal reflection it propagate inside the fiber. If it is incident at this angle, so it will propagate. So this is the only ray trajectory of the strip index fiber. And how wave fronts are generated, you can see for this ray, this is the direction of wave propagation, and the perpendicular of this direction of wave propagation is the wave front. You can see the perpendicular to this is the wave front. Then for this wave, perpendicular to this is the wave front. For this wave, perpendicular to this is the wave front. So this is the basically wave front generated inside the core region. Now you can see the more clear picture by the next slide. This is we consider only the single ray. Single ray means this is the incident ray at this angle. The wave fronts are perpendicular to these rays. This basically this is the zero at zero angle, pi angle, 2 pi, 3 pi are the wave front corresponding to incident ray, phase front corresponding to incident rays. Then the reflected rays, this is the reflected rays, and the wave front, these are the wave front, basically 0, pi, 2 pi, 3 pi, 4 pi, 5 pi, basically the phase front corresponding to reflected rays. So we consider only the single ray. Now you can see, when here I use the two different colors for the even multiple of the phase front is denoted by the green dotted green line 0, 2 pi, 4 pi, 6 pi, and the odd multiple of the phase front is denoted by the red color, and it's pi, 3 pi, 5 pi, 7 pi. Clear? When green line intercept by the green line, means even multiple of the phase front is intercept by the even multiple of the incident phase front, now the constructive interference are generated. If odd multiple of phase front of incident light is intercept with the odd multiple of phase front of the reflected rays, then it is generated the destructive interference. Clear? So basically these interference are very helpful to the wave propagation. If constructive interference are generated, now the field magnitude are maximum. If destructive interference are generated, the field magnitude are minimum, I mean zero. Clear? So you can see here at this point, the green line is intercepted by the green line. So this is the constructive interference are generated. At this point, you can find where the maximum magnitude are present. Clear? Similarly, green intercepted by red line, this is the field pattern is zero. Again, from here, green to green, maximum. Red to red, again maximum. Red green interception, green red interception give the minimum field magnitude inside the core region. Clear? So you can see at the output of the fiber, you can see here from this diagram, this is the field pattern inside the cohesion. Maximum, minimum, maximum, minimum, maximum, minimum, maximum. When green light intercept with the green light or red light intercept with the red light. I mean, if odd multiple of the phase front corresponding to incident rays intercept with the odd multiple of phase front corresponding to reflected rays, it gives the constructive interference. Or if even multiple of the phase front corresponding to incident rays with the corresponding to reflected rays, again give the maximum field pattern. But if it intercept with the odd multiple of the phase front of the reflected with the even multiple of the phase front of the incident, or even with the incident with the odd with the reflected, it give the minimum field pattern of the optical fiber. So this is the expanding. Now you can see this diagram. So this is the core region. In core region, basically the standing kind of the wave are propagating, and in the cladding region, it exponentially decaying and up, going up to the infinite distances. Clear? The magnitude of field present in the cladding region is very very minimum, and it goes up to the infinite distances. Why? In the core region, this is the standing wave kind of the field are present. At the lambda by 4 distance, it becomes 0. Then maximum, 0, maximum. So this is the field pattern is described by the wave model. So this diagram basically shows the which type of field mode are present in the collision. So this is the TE0 mode. 0 mode means there is no any line crosses of the, this is the cladding, this is the core. This is the, I mean, interference line. This is the interference line. If there is no any intercept in the interference line, so this is the zero. TE1, there is one zero crossing. One zero crossing means this line is also known as zero. Zero crossing line or interception line. There is no any interception on the zero crossing line. That is the zero. TE1, one represents the one zero crossing. This is the one zero crossing. TE2 means two zero crossing. One zero crossing is here, other is here. So by this way now we define the mode of the field present inside the core region. Clear? So this is the field pattern in the core region. So in next slide I am going to discuss about the wave theory model and apply on the optical fiber cable. When we analyze the ray theory model, we assume that the optical signal as a ray, optics ray. When we analyze the wave model, we assume that the optical light or light signal is a wave, is an electromagnetic wave. Clear? Because of the our optical fiber is a cylindrical type, cylinder type, we assume that this is the cylindrical wave guide. Clear? Then we have to apply the vector analysis on the optical fiber cable. We apply the vector analysis on the optical fiber cable to calculate the magnitude of field present in the field present in the core region is the longitudinal types or the transverse type. What is the difference between longitudinal field and the transverse field? If the present field in the medium is perpendicular to the direction of the wave propagation, that field is known as transverse field. If the field present in the medium is parallel to the wave propagation or along with the direction of wave propagation, that field is known as longitudinal field. Clear? So from this diagram, now you can say that this is the optical fiber cable, this is the cross section of the optical fiber, this is the center of the fiber. From here, this A, basically this is radius of the fiber, and X is the axial distance, phi is the azimuthal angle, R is the radial distance. So this is the cylindrical shape of the fiber. Then we apply the cylindrical coordinate system. Cylindrical coordinate system is defined by R phi z. R is the radial distance, phi is the azimuthal angle. Azimuthal angle means angle subtended through the cross section of the medium or cross section of the fiber. So z is the direction of wave propagation. Clear? So this is the, now we have to apply the cylindrical coordinate system to compute the different value of the optical fiber cable. So first we have to apply it, because of the optical fiber cable is the waveguide, cylindrical waveguide. There is no any conducting medium. Then we apply the Maxwell's equation for the source free medium. So basically rho v and the conduction current is zero because the medium is non-conducting medium. It is the waveguide. Then apply the delta d equals to rho. Rho is zero. Volume charge density is zero because it is the non-conducting medium. Delta d equals to zero. Delta b equals to zero. This is the Maxwell's first equation. Maxwell's second equation. Maxwell's third equation. Del cross e equals to minus del b upon del t, where b is the magnetic flux density and del cross s equals to minus del t upon del t. Basically this is equals to jd upon jc, displacement current plus the conduction current density. Because of this the non-conducting, so this value is zero. So this is approximately equals to only displacement current density. So displacement current density equals to minus del t upon del t. Okay, where B is the magnetic flux density, this is equals to mu h, and D is the electric flux density, which is equals to epsilon e. Now taking the curl of the equation, curl of this equation, del cross e. So curl means del cross e equals to minus del in cross del b upon del t. By substituting this value, now we will find the wave equation corresponding to electric field. Wave equation corresponding to electric field means del square E equals to mu epsilon del square E upon dt square. So this is the wave equation corresponding to electric field. By doing same procedure, again taking the curl of del cross H, we will find the wave equation corresponding to magnetic field. So we will find the wave equation corresponding to electric field, and similarly wave equation corresponding to magnetic field is del square H equals to mu epsilon del square H upon dt square. So this is the wave equation corresponding to magnetic field. So these equations can be calculated by applying the Maxwell's equation and taking the curl of del cross curl of equation, Maxwell's third equation, give the wave equation corresponding to electric field. Taking the curl of Maxwell's fourth equation, I mean del cross H, we will find the wave equation corresponding to magnetic field. So these are the next slide I am going to discuss about the, when we find the solution of this wave equation. When we find the solution of this wave equation, it gives the Bessel's function. When we again find the solution of this wave equation corresponding to magnetic field, it also gives the Bessel's equation. So basically the Bessel's equation, so from next slide you can see, when we find the solution of the Bessel's equation, we find the solution of wave equation corresponding to electric field and the solution of wave equation corresponding to magnetic field, we will have the solutions. That solution is known as the Bessel's equations. The Bessel's equation is basically del square r upon del r square plus 1 by r, I mean small r radial distance, upon del capital R upon del r, plus q square minus nu square upon r square into r equals to 0. So this equation is known as Bessel's equations, where q is the complex function. So q square equals to omega square mu epsilon minus beta square, where beta is the propagation constant in the medium and r is the radial variation of the electric and magnetic field, omega is the angular frequency, mu is the permeability of the medium, epsilon is the permittivity of the medium. Clear? Because the our optical fiber cable is the waveguide, then this mu is equals to mu naught, basically the relative permeability of the free space or medium, and this is the permittivity. Permittivity is the variable. Permittivity of the co-region is the different from the permittivity of the cladding region. Clear? So basically this mu equals to mu naught, while this is equals to epsilon naught into epsilon r. Clear? Now, if again we have found the solution of this Bessel's equation, it gives the three types of solution. If we assume that this value and that solution is dependent upon this complex quantity q, if we assume that this q is real, now this Bessel's equation gives the another kind of solution. If we assume that this q is imaginary, now it gives the another kind of solution of the Bessel's equation. If we assume that this q is complex, now we have the another kind of solution. That solutions you can see from this slide. When we assume that this q is real, then the solutions are Bessel's functions, means general Bessel's function. The general Bessel's function is, our Bessel's functions are Neumann's function, where nu is the order of the function and q is the argument of the function. When we assume that this q is the imaginary, then it gives the another kind of solution known as the Bessel's function of the first kind and second kind. So Bessel's function of the first kind and the second kind. If we assume that this q is the complex, then the solution of Bessel's functions is the Hankel functions of the first kind and the Hankel functions of the second kind. The Hankel functions are needed for analyzing propagation in lossy medium, while we assume that only this optical fiber is the lossless medium. Clear? Lossless medium is, so this is not applicable for the basically the BTEC level. So we can assuming by the for higher studies. We consider only these two conditions, q is real, q is imaginary, because in your syllabus we assume that only this optical fiber cable is the lossless medium. Clear? In next slides, I am going to discuss about, basically this is the, if we assume that q is real, then the solution are the Bessel's function and the Neumann function. So this diagram is give the Bessel's functions and this is the Neumann's function. From the waveform you can see that at the origin, at zero value, the magnitude of Bessel's function is how much? That is the 1. Means maximum. At this time, J1 is the less than 3. This is the, I mean, at the origin of the fiber, at the center of the fiber, now it has the maximum magnitude of field present. When you move from the, moving away from the center of the fiber, now the magnitude are decreasing and it continuously going up to the infinite distances. I mean this. Now you can also see from the Neumann function, at the center the magnitude is 0. Magnitude is 0. When you move away from the center, it has the magnitude are increased. Clear? While we know that at the center the maximum field are present by after total internal reflection. So this is the applicable, this solution is applicable for the field present in the core region. While we assume that q is the real function. So by second diagram you can see that when we assume that q is imaginary, then the solution is the modified Bessel's function of the first kind and the modified Bessel's function of the second kind. If we apply from the basic theory of the ray model, we know that at the center it is the maximum fields are present, and at the core cladding boundary, at the cladding region, now the field exponentially decaying and goes up to the infinite distances, right? Now compare this waveform with the basic theory. So at this, at the center, magnitude is 0. When we move away from the center of the fiber, now the magnitude of fields are exponentially increased. So this is not applicable for the field present in core and cladding. Clear? Come to the second diagram, that is the modified Bessel's function of the second kind. Second kind means this is the k0, first coefficient of the modified Bessel's function of second kind, k1, k2, first coefficient, second, third. Now you can see at the center, at the origin, you had the maximum fluid present. When you move away from the center of the fiber, now the fluid is exponentially decaying and it goes up to the infinite distance. So this modified Bessel's function are responsible or applicable to determine the fluid present in the cladding region. So we have the two solutions. Modified general Bessel's function are useful to find the fluid pattern in the origin, while the modified Bessel's function of second kind are useful to determine the magnitude of field in core region, cladding region. And third, if we assume Q is complex, so this is used for the lossy medium, but here we analyze only the lossless medium, so this is not applicable for the BTech courses. So this is the field distribution present in the fiber. So this is the alternative Bessel's function is applicable for the core region, and modified Bessel's function is applicable for the cladding region to find the different field value present in core and cladding. So where general Bessel's function is denoted by the J nu Kr. J nu Qr, nu is the order of the field, Q is the argument, J is the Bessel's function coefficient. And here K nu Qr. K is the modified Bessel's function of second kind coefficient, nu is the order of the field, Qr is the argument of the field. Right? So these are the basically find out by applying the wave theory model. Clear? Then how to calculate the field component distribution? The optical fiber has a circular waveguide instead of the planar. The solution of the Maxwell's equation, field in core are nautical in nature, basically J nu, Bessel's function of general Bessel's function are suitable for the field distribution, while in cladding, the fields are cladding are decaying natures, so modified Bessel's function of second kind are suitable for the field distribution. So these are the two mode numbers to specify the mode. M is the radial mode number, basically determine how many zero crossing in the radial direction. Nu is the angular mode numbers, basically define the variation of field amplitude in the phi or in the azimuthal directions. Clear? So by applying the wave theory model, we find that the magnitude of field present in the core and cladding region. Clear? In next lecture, I will discuss about the what magnitude of transverse field or what magnitude of the longitudinal fields are present in core and cladding region. Thank you.